So hello and welcome. Happy Friday. Today is Black Friday here in the United States, which is a big shopping day right after Thanksgiving. And it is November the 27th. Outside it's 44 degrees Fahrenheit, which in Celsius is 6.666. This is episode number 86 of Backyard Beekeeping Questions and Answers. And the questions we're going over today are relevant to what people have submitted over the past week. And thank you for those of you who submitted that. And we have some fun today because we're going to talk about, at the very end, gift ideas for beekeepers. Beekeepers are not the easiest people to shop for, so we're going to go into that. And that's pretty much it. If you have a question or you want to know what we're going to go over today, look down in the video description, line item by line item. And as we've been doing before, if you go ahead and put the timestamps for all the questions in order here, and this is a short one today, your post, your comment will be the tagged comment, and it will be held at the top so other people can see. And I appreciate those who are trying to do that. I very much appreciate it. And what else can we say? I hope everybody's having a good time, and this is the way to be. So we're going to get right into the first question from Rodney Rowland. Big fan of YouTube videos and wanted to see where you got the pattern to burn on the front of the hive in your FlowHive 2 unboxing video. I want to burn them on the new boxes that I'm making now. Please let me know. Thanks. I'm new to beekeeping and learn a lot from the videos. So, and thank you for commenting and for asking that question. Here's the thing. When it comes to personalizing and customizing your bee boxes, guess what I just did? Because of this question, I made a playlist. And so you can go to my channel. It'll also be down in the video description here. The playlist for pyrography and customization of beehives. What the heck is pyrography? Pyrography is just wood burning. That's changed a lot from when I was a kid, because when I was a kid, you had these little wood burning tools that were made out of copper. It was shaped like a chisel and you just burned the wood. Now the tools are much more sophisticated, as is the procedure. So one of the things I wanted to talk about today, because it's something that people can do maybe when they're inside and winter is upon them and they've got nothing to do. Don't put together your new hive boxes yet. Keep the panels separate, set them out. And one of the ways, now I'm an artist, I have a background in fine art, so painting, multimedia, everything. So I can freehand that stuff, but we are burning on wood, so your mistakes are forever. It's kind of like sketching with pen and ink. All the marks that you make are permanent. You have to build from it. Nothing wrong with that if you have that confidence, but some people want to look for patterns and stuff, like what patterns did I use? Where did I get the images that I use? This is the second person this week that's asked about the very same thing. So one of the things that you can source for layouts is adult coloring books. And adult coloring books are, they're too sophisticated for kids. The lines are refined, the subject matter sometimes can be very advanced, so little kids don't get them for coloring. But when you get those, the sheets are 8.5 by 11 inches, and they're already laid out. So then what you can do is get an image that's nature-related or bee-related or pollinator-related. There's butterfly books, and I looked at them, and I wasn't real excited about the quality of the illustration work in there. But here's the thing. They break it down into very simple lines because they're designed for you to use colored pencils or craypaws or oil pastels and things like that, and crayons, of course. And so you can take those, and you can also get an 8.5 by 11 inch sheet of graphite paper. So that's pretty big. I mean, the size of a bee box is not that big. So then you can lay your reference piece on top of the graphite, and then you just basically sketch over it and outline it on right onto the wood. And then you remove that. Now you have a basic outline there, and you can go in and do your pyrography, and you can test it out and try it and see what's going on. And I find that pine works really well because it's high contrast. And you can also do it on cedar. Cedar is very soft and cedar burns easily, and it looks great when you're first done with it, which I did for the video that Rodney here is asking about. But cedar gets really dark because after you finish your wood burning project, you can add color to it with oil pencils. And I demonstrate that in some of the videos that I'm in, that's in this playlist below. So the oil pencils, everything, once you're done with it all, then you're gonna have to clear coat everything because it has to be weatherproof. And the cedar gets really dark. That's all I have to say about that. So the Australian hoop pine boxes are really good for wood burning. They're high contrast again, they burn easy. And then of course, regular pine here in the United States. So it's a great way to personalize your stuff and it's a lot of fun. And you can just freeform it, do whatever you want. But that's what I do, and I put together that playlist just for that. So coloring books, graphite, you can also just use your printer, of course, at home. And you can look for clip art and look for PNG style. PNG is just a format, which usually means a clear background. You can get some very basic outlines. So those are good starters. And then once your confidence is built up, you can go ahead and do some real artwork on your beehives. Backyard beekeepers are notorious for overly ornamenting their beehives. And there's some pretty funny jokes out there about commercial beekeepers or your first beehive and it's super elaborate, looks like a little Victorian cottage. And then, 5 years into it, it's got all the white boxes that are just kind of disheveled and stacked, haphazardly. There's some truth to that when you're brand new to beekeeping, although I've been doing it for years, I still like to do, unqualified, overly ornamented hives from time to time. It's just fun. And if you're gifting something to someone, maybe you'd like to do some personalization on it. It's a lot of fun. So that's about it for that. And what else did I want to talk about today? If you have a question of your own, write it down in the comments section or follow the links in the video description, which will take you to a form that you can fill out. And the next thing is here, Brian, I'm going to mess up this last name, Vogel, maybe, Vigel, from Burleson, Texas. It says here, Friday Q&A number 85, you mentioned that bringing in swarms may have contributed to the mite population in your apiary, as well as possibly impacting your bee weaver colonies by increasing mite loads due to drift from one hive to the next. If someone was wanting to increase the number of hives in their apiary, would they be better off staying away from the free bees collected in a swarm and only increase their hive count through splits or the purchase of packages or nucs, which are nucleus colonies? And this is recent. We're talking a lot recently about biosecurity in your backyard beekeeping in any bee yard. And I'm guilty of this. It occurred to me when I was looking at that we go out there sometimes and we get a swarm from who knows where, just because somebody called and we're like, free bees, and we get them and we bring them back. You put them in your beehive, bring them back, and where do you put them? Right next to the bees that you currently keep. Now, some people, I have neighbors like this, that have composed their entire apiary based on swarms that they collect in the area. So I think half of those bees are probably mine. But anyway, so if they collect swarms and that's what their entire apiary is composed of, they already start to know what the disposition is of the colonies that they have, how healthy they are, how well they get through winter, and all of these other things, as well as their great traits. Maybe they're great pollinators. Maybe they're super good at Varroa resistance on their own. So here's the thing, but once you've established your backyard apiary, so this is not as critical. I mean, you're going to bring in a package of bees or a nucleus of bees when you're just starting out because you have to get your bees from somewhere. There's no guarantee that the bees that you're bringing in are clean. So when you get a package of bees, this is where it gets to being very critical about where you're sourcing your bees. Get your bees from, from breeders that have a great reputation. And it wasn't necessarily that the feral bees that we brought in, because there's only one unknown origin hive of bees, colony of bees that I had in my backyard last year. And that's because we took it out of an old house the previous fall. So they actually made it through winter. They were very strong. And the risk you run is we don't know what's going on with those bees. We don't know if they're bringing disease with them. We don't know when you collect a swarm and don't know where it came from. You don't know that the swarm wasn't just an absconded colony. So in other words, they may have left completely from whatever cavity they were in because of disease. So the thinking is, and this is, again, this is the most cautious move you can do, which is not to bring unknown origin swarms of bees into your established apiary where you're already doing very well, I hope. But then the argument could be, if you're doing really well, why are you bringing in other bees? So like me, to see what the other bees are like, and then to share with people on YouTube what the Saskatchewan bees were like. For example, and before that, the bee weaver bees. And what I started out with back in 2007 would be the Italian bees. So I've been through several lines, you know, races of bees, bee stock. And so then I look for the traits that I really like. And so the problem is, you should be having kind of a quarantine apiary somewhere, where when you're bringing in a fresh caught swarm in a box, that you don't put them right in your apiary right away. And the recommendation is a year. And I can't explain all the details as to why they recommend a year, but you can't fail. If you have a friend that's got a rural property, for example, and they think it would be cool to have some bees out there, but they don't want to be beekeepers, but they're okay with you putting a colony out there, then if you're going to bring in a new unknown origin colony of bees, put them on that person's property that has given you their permission. And then now you can evaluate those bees away from your own apiary and see how well they do. And in the meantime, of course, you're monitoring the colonies under your control in your own backyard, and in the case of a lot of people that are watching here. And then you'll know what their strengths and weaknesses are, and whether or not they get overwhelmed with disease, whether or not they couldn't handle varroa. Maybe those are traits you don't want. So this is kind of, I mean, what if I told everybody don't collect swarms from all over the place? So then in the meantime, when people call a beekeepers association, in my case, a Northwest Pennsylvania Beekeepers Association, they have a list of beekeepers that are willing to go and collect swarms. So the question is, what do you do with them once you get them? And maybe they're fine with bringing them right to their bee yards and bolstering their colonies that way. But now, for me, because beekeeping is always a matter of changing practices, learning as you go, and adapting your practices for better health and well-being for the bees under your care and control. So for me, this year, I won't be bringing any swarms that did not come from my apiary. So it's one thing to have a colony in my apiary that gets really big, splits, swarms. They said that swarm out and they're on a tree branch, you know, 50 feet, 100 yards from my own apiary, and those are my bees. So there are a lot of things that go on there because now I can keep those. Those are mine already. I know their history. We also know they're doing really well because they swarmed and left, you know, a parent stock community in the hive, which is different from absconding where that hive would be completely empty. So this all gets into, let's control our equipment. Let's not bring in used equipment. Likewise, let's not bring in bees that may have come out of used equipment that could be contaminated. So what would be the worst thing they could bring with them? Well, foul brood. What's the worst foul brood that they could bring? Well, they could bring American foul brood, so that would be really bad. And how would you know if they had it? Well, you know, colonies that have American foul brood, the good news is they tend to not last very long. They tend to die out. That's why it's such an extreme disease, which, by the way, is pretty much in decline, so that's a good thing. So how would you bring foul brood into your apiary? Well, it could be a colony that absconds because foul brood exists in the colony that they came from. You could also have a friend that, you know, I'm just getting out of beekeeping, all my bees died last year, and I want to give away all my hive equipment, and it's, you know, thousands of dollars worth of hive equipment. You just think, yes, please, and you get that stuff and you bring it home. Foul brood can exist in the hive equipment for over 40 years. So when people ask, can I bring in frames? Can I get frames from a friend? You know, my friend's going to give me frames of brood. You're putting a lot of confidence and faith in your friend and in their practices and keeping their bees and what diseases there may be. So what you're potentially doing is bringing in frames of brood to boost your stock, but the brood may in fact have already been diseased in some way. So if you practice biosecurity with your apiary, you will know what you have. And there's still exposure because the bees are flying out, they're on flowers, and that's going to come up later in this discussion too, but you're reducing your risks overall. So this is why I recommend not gathering swarms of unknown origin and then bringing them right to your apiary. Get them, but put them somewhere else for now. And I've done this before too. When there's somebody that's brand new to beekeeping that doesn't own any bees, then I will tell them to meet me at a swarm collection site where somebody placed a call and they said, we got a swarm of bees in our yard. We'll have them meet me there with their hive equipment and we'll load them up and send them home with their brand new bees. So that's one way to start off with free bees, but those are the only bees that they'll have in their apiary because they're just starting. So now they'll be able to learn quickly, you know, what the disposition of those bees is. So let's see, through spits or purchasing of new. So within your own apiary, you're much better off. I mean, I have no goal of rapid expansion. In fact, I want to reduce the numbers of colonies in my backyard apiary because I want them to be manageable and I want to intimately know what's going on with each and every colony. If I were a commercial beekeeper, my outlook would be entirely different, but I'm not. We're about backyard beekeeping. So I'm gonna go this year with biosecurity. I'm not bringing in new bees, and I'm gonna work with the bees that I have, the swarms that they generate. I'll make splits from them, and I may bring in queens again from reputable breeders that we know that their stock is good. So for me, the Saskatraz line of bees has been up and down. Some people had a great experience with them. Some people had high mite loads with them, and the mite load is commented on here. But even friends that started exclusively, this is their first year with bees, didn't have any other bees. Two colonies of Saskatraz bees out by themselves, overwhelmed by Varroa destructor mites. So we know then that those can't handle that, and I avoid it. If those have been in my backyard apiary, of course, we have to do mite counts. And then you have a decision to make. Are you going to treat those if they have high mite loads, or are you going to get rid of them? So these are very divergent methods of managing bees right now. You know, do you keep working with bees that require treatment to continue, or do you focus on stock that requires little to no treatment and makes it very well on their own, and then you don't sabotage them by bringing in the weaker stock to live right next door, and then through drifting, sharing landing boards and things like that, affecting one another. This one, it's bad because it's almost never the case where the strong, healthy, survivor stock, Varroa-resistant, hygienic bees go the other way and fix by proximity a hive that's not doing well. So this hive that's overwhelmed with mites over here doesn't, because it has a neighbor right next door that handles mites well. They don't get over there and go, yeah, let's help kick out those mites. And it goes the other way. The diseased bees tend to infect negatively the colony that would have done extremely well had it been better separated from the colony that wasn't doing well. So if you're a new beekeeper, I apologize, because these are areas that beekeepers are very polarized about, and you can get very strong opinions in every direction on that. So would replacing a queen from a feral swarm, or at least one not from your apiary, with a survivor line queen be an effective way to grow the apiary and still support your existing survivor line hives? So here's my thing about that. So the idea here is, what if we catch a swarm and we bring it home and we put it in a hive and we stick it in our apiary, but then once they're established and they start laying eggs and the brood starts to get established and we get that queen in there and we get rid of her, then we bring in another queen, and that's from a reputable queen breeder, and we install that one. And now, of course, 21 days after that, once that queen has started laying, we know that the new stock being generated in that colony, and ultimately the entire colony, will be from that queen's genetics. Now that might work, but is it better than, listen to this, is it better than staying with the colony that's already in your backyard, being more patient about that? Because see, we get in a rush and we want to build this backyard apiary fast in some cases. But what if we waited and watched, and the two or three hives that you might have in your backyard, you pick the strongest one that's going to build up, because this is what's going to happen in spring. They build up at an incredible rate. That's your opportunity to split the colonies and then order your queens in advance so that you know if your queen is going to arrive on Monday and it's Thursday, that's a good time to do the split on Thursday, because you split them apart. By Monday, you will know if which one ended up with the queen in it. Hopefully you got the queen and moved her with the split, so the resident colony is without the queen, and that's where you're going to put the one that you flew in. The other thing that we're doing this year is clipping the queen wings on the right side only or the left side only, because we're going to keep our stock local. I am. And these are, I'm sharing my practices with you. I'm not telling you what you have to do, but I am explaining my logic behind it. I want to keep my genetics close. I want to purify my bee yard and keep only the genetics of the stock that are doing really well. And I will be doing internal splits. And then if I find myself queenless, this can happen. You can do a split and you can find out that both of your colonies now from the split, the colony that you took from and the new one that you established, they can both end up queenless for some reason. And that's when you would fly in two queens and requeen them both. And keep records, even if you only have two hives, write everything down, what happened when, how you did the split, what you noticed, and then we'll control the stock and the traits of the queens that we have in there. So if you can successfully split your own stock and keep them local, now you're going to generate a new queen, right? Because this is the next argument that comes up. You're going to generate new queens. They're virgins. They're unmated. They're going to fly, and they're going to mate. And they're going to fly up to 9 miles. And they're going to mate with drones of unknown origin. So now have you not just potentially, again, brought in disease to your apiary? Much reduced, much more reduced than if you brought in the entire swarm from somewhere else, because they're carrying everything with them. A swarm of bees, by the way, can be followed by small hive beetles. Small hive beetles can fly with the swarm of bees. They can leave with varroa mites already on them. So the chances of your queen running out and mating with, at the drone congregation area, mating with a bunch of drones who are going to pass on varroa and pass on other problems is much reduced than if you're trying to collect an entire swarm that you don't know its traits. That's kind of a dead horse, I guess, beating there. But that's the thing. And then, of course, only reproduce from your colonies that you know are doing well. And this is where your records are going to come in. We're about to go through winter. I've already reduced my colony from 19 to 15. 15 or 16 is what we're reduced to going into winter. Because here's the thinking. You want to get rid of your weak colonies going into winter, not coming out in spring. So when you have colonies that you already know are struggling, the numbers are low, they have a very low heat signature, if you're fortunate enough to have a thermal cam or something like that. And so combining those colonies now with stronger colonies, the weak colony going on top of the stronger colony, or just getting rid of them altogether, if there's a bunch of other issues with that hive. And I have an advantage to where I can now look for nosema loads and things like that, but this time of year, Nosema serrana loads, the bacteria problems in their gut, if it exists at all this time of year for your colony, are very low. Those things peak in spring. So right now, the colonies can look really good. So now we're just looking at numbers and looking at the overall health of the colony, and is there a queen in there? There are a lot of things that contribute to how we're going to manage. So I'm going to focus on a reduction in numbers going into the fall, so I don't have bees that have to be handheld through winter. We're going to focus on those that have enough stores going in, because we had no late season swarms this year. Last year I had 3 or 4 late season swarms that all made it, by the way. But they had to be fed and they had to be taken care of. And then in the spring when they build up, those are the ones that will expand and go back to 19 or 20 colonies in the apiary from that stock that overwinters. So these are all philosophies that you're going to kind of have to work out on your own. And also, it says, tying into your response to Suzanne, could you expand more about when and why you replace queens in your established hives? The only times I personally am replacing queens in my established hives is when I inspect the hive and they're queenless. There's no queen, and I don't see queen cells. So they were caught off guard. Something happened to their queen. There were no eggs, there were no larvae, nothing was going on in there. And so I actually had that situation last year with 2 colonies that I combined, and one of them had a laying worker in it, at least one, probably more. And I successfully combined them with the newsprint method. The larger colony was on the bottom layer of newsprint, poked holes in it. The smaller, weaker colony goes on top of that. And then they combined, and I flew in a weaver queen and establish them, and they're doing great. They're one of the strong colonies going into winter now. But again, we know the genetics because they actually came from, one of them was Saskatrass, one of them was Weaver, and they're a Weaver colony, bee Weaver colony now. So I don't just go in, look at queens or look at performance, brood pattern and stuff like that, and then decide, well, I need to get rid of that queen. I've never actually had to do that, thank goodness. So I don't have to requeen just for the benefit of that colony, but then I do get it from stock, and I'm going to continue to work with the bee weaver line, and I'm going to focus exclusively on those next year. I'm going to let the, if the Saskatrass continue, the ones that I still have, if they continue to do well, I'm going to continue to work with those. But as they die out or weaken on their own, I will just, if ever I have to requeen any of those colonies, it's going to be bee weaver, which is different from our weaver. Here's the next question. This is from Deborah Hauser, Seneca, Pennsylvania. So where can I find more info about long Langstroth hives for our climate? By the way, Venango is where she's from. You've said the top of our hives don't do well as far north. Why? Is it because of their lack of depth? Now, I did say top of our hives may do okay. It's just everyone I know here that's tried them. I had a good friend at the Whole Foods Co-op and head of their education department there. And he tried year after year with his top bar hives. He went to some workshops up in Vermont, came back all inspired, set up top bar hives in his apiary. And none of those hives survived. And in fact, I think most of them, the bees absconded. They left the hive. So he was, you know, unhappy with that. And he went to the standard Langstroth size hive. So it's not that I'm saying they don't make it this far north. Some people are showing that they can. Other people are having terrible, because here's what I like to do. If I find someone that has a top bar hive and it's working really well where I live in my area, I like to go over there, strike up a conversation, and just be there, be a, you know, fly on the wall when they're doing their inspection. I can see how it works out, what they like or don't like about it. And that has failed at every turn here, so I don't have anybody to visit with. But like, my friend Bob over at the Whole Foods, he went to Vermont. Obviously, somebody up there is holding workshops and teaching about top bar hives. So somebody's making it work. I don't know if they're super insulated. The line of bees that they're using could have a lot to do with that. In fact, I think the line of bees that we use has a lot to do with how successful we think we are as beekeepers. Because the bees do so well, you know, we pat ourselves on the back and say, yeah, it's because I put that insulated cover on there. Or, yeah, it's because I use this kind of foundation or something. But the stock of the bees is at the very core of you succeeding with your bees. And so really hardy bees can do well. Well-nourished bees can do really well in a lot of different configurations. So it's just that I don't know of anybody that's had that work here where I live. And so since winters want to move straight up, does winter feeding through the hole of a shim discourage moving laterally, for example, to adjacent frames? And if you recall, this is my first year with horizontal hives. So, and I'm doing the horizontal long Langstroth hive, and that's what's being talked about here. And I have to plug somebody's book, of course, Dr. Leo Sherishkin. He's, I think, the editor for this book. This only came out this year, by the way. This came out in 2020. And I have pages of notes from this book because I am experimenting with horizontal hives. There's no question that Dr. Sherishkin does not personally like the horizontal long Langstroth hive. So, Fred, why the heck are you doing a long Langstroth hive? And I want to do one of those too. Well, it's just because of convenience. It's the beekeeper's convenience because equipment is made for Langstroth hives. If it's a horizontal Langstroth and it's compatible with all that gear. But I have to say, and I've got one sitting here and I haven't put it out yet. It came fully assembled, ready to go. It is the lay-ins hive, so I will be installing bees. We talk about bee splits at the beginning of today. I'm going to be doing my splits and putting them in my lay-ins hive. And I've gone the extra yard on that. But I think Dr. Leo, as they like to call him, from Missouri. Well, that's where he lives. He's obviously not even from the United States initially. But he likes a deep frame because the bees need to move up. But to answer this question, will they move horizontally? When I put together my horizontal long Langstroth hive, I used better comb and I used foundationless. because the bees can chew holes through it and make their pathways, which they have. If you've looked at, by the way, I did put together a playlist of nothing but my horizontal hive experience, and that's going to be in there. The lands hive is going to be added to that. So if you want to click on, you know, if you want to follow that progress, there's only 3 videos there now. But if you want to follow, I'm going to be openly critical of my own system if it's not working, and I'm going to celebrate the aspects that do work. And I think that Dr. Leo has established himself. HorizontalHive.com is their website. He's established himself as, you know, in the United States, there's nobody more experienced and capable with horizontal hive configurations and the bee biology and his method of beekeeping with a smile. There's nobody that's superior to Dr. Leo in that realm. So I hope people take a hard look at him. He does talk about the Langstroth hive, and the bees will go through that comb horizontally. This is why I don't use plastic foundation in there. No acorn, no solid foundation, because the bees do need to communicate and transfer themselves horizontally on the days. When do they do that? They're going to do that when the days warm up a little bit and we get those weird warm-ups during the wintertime. Nobody can predict the weather around here. I'm in the worst weather area ever. So it was supposed to be 55 today. It's 44. So when it warms up into the 50s in the middle of winter, or it hits the 60s, which it can on some days, that's when the bees kind of move themselves around, if they don't have brood locking them into one spot. This is the problem I would forecast with a shallow, you know, 10 or 11 inch, the depth of that horizontal long Langstroth hive is made by a 2x12 stock, which is, you know, 11 and a half inches height interior. And we know that these frames are 9 inches tall, so they're going to have to move laterally through there to survive. And I don't know how well they're doing until the end of the year, but you're ahead of the game if you use a lay-ins hive, which has the deep frames. And Dr. Leo is going to tell everybody that. He's probably very frustrated. He doesn't know me, doesn't know who I am. But I'm sure if he met me, he would be very frustrated that I, to satisfy so many viewers that frequently asked about, go lower, you know, tell us about the long Langstroth, try a long Langstroth. Long Langstroths are great. That's what I'm doing. That's what I'm trying. But Dr. Leo will tell you deeper frames are better for the reasons described, because it's the brood that's going to lock them in place, and then they won't go this way. They can move a little up as they go. And then the brood, of course, they continue to lay as they go up, and they're not completely abandoning it. Where if they do that horizontally, now they need a lot of bees to stay with the brood while the rest of the bees work with the resources that are stored. Although on the warm days, the bees can move out and rearrange honey stores. What they would prefer to do is move as a cluster over the stored honey. Better suited to the lay-ins. And of course that works on the Langstroth vertical hives because they're vertically stacked. They're down in that brood box and they're going to move up together. So right now, if you're talking about Langstroth equipment, the Langstroth vertical boxes would be better than the horizontal Langstroth hive when it comes to wintering. But we're going to see. What else do we have? Since the cluster wants to move straight up, hole or shim for the feeder. Yeah, so the feeder, again, my horizontal hive, my long Langstroth hive, has a feeder. It has a couple of feeder holes in those covers. But some people are saying that the lay-ins hive doesn't have any feeder holes in it, since I haven't even opened my box yet. I don't know how that's configured for feeding. But my long Langstroth hive has wrap-it-around feeders sitting over the holes to plug them, and now they just have dry sugar in them. Or will have. They don't have anything in them right now because there's a pile of honey in there. So I will be able to see, you know, we can unplug those feeder holes right on down the line to make sure that the food is offered over the brood area. So we have a lot going on there. Here's the next one. This is from Nikki Gores. I discovered bubbles in my honey, as shown. She sent pictures. Which was extracted beginning of August of 2020. Fermentation came to my mind right away, so I pulled out my refractometer and the moisture content was exactly what I expected, a tad under 17%. The same as when the honey was extracted and subsequently bottled within hours. To make doubly sure, I borrowed a refractometer from a fellow beekeeper in my bee club and the result was exactly the same. What do you think causes those bubbles? So I responded and said, if it doesn't smell bad, if it doesn't smell like it's souring, if it still smells like honey's supposed to, then I said, just put that jar of honey, loosen the jar lid, put it on 120 to 125 degree water, and heat it up a little bit, see if the bubbles don't dissipate, and if they do, cool it right back down, and you're good to go. That's exactly what she did. The bubbles went up and out, and she cooled it back down and bottled it, and it looks like a perfect jar of honey now. Because what happens is, sometimes these little bubbles of honey, especially when it's honey, late season honey here where I am, has a tendency to crystallize. So the honey has particulates in it, and they can lock air bubbles in place. So warming your honey up a little bit, here's the key to that. You want to warm it to the lowest temperature possible that allows it to get liquid enough to do what you need to do with it, in this case, dissipate bubbles, and then cool it right back down, because the longer it's warm, the longer it's heated, the more the honey degrades. Or you can alter the flavor. You don't want to do that. And number two part of that, so we fix that problem with heat. The number two problem of that is I live in Minnesota and go to my BR daily to check on things. 2 days ago, I collected about a dozen dead bees from one colony's landing board and brought them home for further examination, like you recommended. She probably said, like you recommended. See what we can do with the way text is written with voice inflection. Anyway. I forgot the Ziploc bag, so I gathered them on a small napkin, sat them on my kitchen counter. A couple of hours later, I found several bees crawling all over the kitchen counter, and when I looked at the napkin, the rest of the bees were all moving and alive. Quite shaken up, I gathered them in a container and drove them back to the landing board. What would you have done in that situation? Well, this happens to me. It happens to my wife, because I like to use the kitchen table because there's a huge window right there, and that's where I like to look at my bees. And in the wintertime, when there's dead bees on the landing board, I scoop them onto plates. I zip them, put them in Ziploc bags. I bring them in. I lay everything out. I get my microscope, and I set that all up out there. And then I go to get a cup of coffee or something, or I go do something else. And then I get called to the kitchen, and what's on the window? 30 bees that were just too cold to fly right then. So the question is, why are those bees on the landing board? Why didn't they just go inside? Why didn't they join the cluster? When you're cleaning out, you know, you're taking your kebab things this time of year, and you're going through the entrance and you're cleaning them out. That's how I get my bees that I'm going to look at. They're on the bottom of the landing board in there. Those bees are not doing well. Those are not prime bees. So even though they might have warmed up, which happened under my microscope during my microscopic video that I posted, they start to warm and they start to move around, but you will notice that even though they do come around and they could fly in some cases, most of them can't even fly. What they do is they scoot across the table, bomb to the floor. That's why you don't want to walk through your kitchen barefoot or with just your socks on once your beekeeping family member has been in there looking at bees, because they're probably all over the floor too. And they can sting you, of course, even though if they're in their last throes, but a tiny percentage of them make it to the window and stick on the window. Are they healthy enough? Because part of your assessment can be to look them over to see what their overall physical health looks like, but you don't know what's going on with those bees. So my opinion is, if they're on the bottom, if they're on the landing board, if they're out of commission like that when you collect them, you can, before you examine them, like that, you can put that Ziploc baggie right in the freezer. 10 minutes is all you need. And finish them off. If you go out and put them back on the landing board, they need to go back to the landing board that they came from. 9 times out of 10, so then this is the starfish on the beach thing, you know. 9 times out of 10, so there's the 10th one that's probably good to go. 9 of them are not going to make it, and we're on their way out, and we're in profound decline to begin with. So keep them in your Ziploc baggie, and you can go ahead and do that. So if you're inspecting for Nosema and stuff like that, because we're going to take them apart, and we're going to take their abdomens off, and we're going to put them in a Ziploc baggie, 100 of them, and then we're going to use a jar and roll them and crush them, and then we're going to put water in there, and then we're going to look for Nosema spores underneath the microscope. But so we're going to use them as samples to see how loaded, what, you know, if they're loaded with Nosema, then we know that colony's got a problem. So, yeah, keep them in your Ziploc baggie until you know. But that does happen. Happens to me. So that's what I would do. Just scoop them all up. And when we talk about the gifts for beekeepers, at the end of this segment today, I'm going to show you something that you can use to collect bees on your windowsill, on the floor, on the walls, even on the ceiling if they get up there. So thank you for that question. Here's the next one from Patricia, whose name I cannot even pronounce, from Chile. Varas, Chile. It says, thanks for a wonderful channel. Now this is something, this is going to be interesting to a lot of people, even though this is occurring in Chile, but there are things that you may not be thinking about when you are keeping bees. And I discovered a couple of weeks ago, I'm learning a lot as well and enjoying the way you narrate. Thank you so much. And let's go on down here. I'm a newbie, just starting with one nuke and a swarm. For those of you who don't know, a nuke is a nucleus, which usually is about 5 frames. Bees with the development of all stages in there. And with one nuke and a swarm I caught a week ago, I've been listening to all your Q&A that I can. I live in Puerto Varas, Chile, Lake District. We don't get snow here in winter, but a lot of rain. So everything is green and lush. We have a very diverse, abundant native forest. So the bees are happy. My question is, related to the Bombus terrestris, or European bumblebee, which has been introduced into Chile to pollinate tomatoes in commercial greenhouses. Of course, they've escaped and now are all over the country. They have decimated our native Bombus dalbombi, which population is down on 90%. That's right, she says. All this with the consent of our agricultural department. That is also right and unbelievable, and I am so amazed by this. The imported bumblebee has passed down diseases to our native one. Amongst other inconveniences, I'm wondering if it will also affect the honeybees. Do you know if the European bumblebee will carry different diseases that could affect honeybees? Here in southern Chile, we have many Corniolan bees due to the long rainy winters we get. Thanks, Patricia. So here's the thing. I don't know about the native bees, bumblebees and other species that are bringing diseases to our non-native pollinators and managed honeybee colonies. But I do know this. Science Daily, June 26th, 2019, University of Vermont, the students determined that deformed wing virus and black queen cell virus are being passed from commercial beekeeping colonies to native pollinators, including the bumblebees there. They tested flowers. So the flower is where the bees are passing on their diseases. Deformed wing virus is a serious thing. The thing that we associate that with most often with our honeybees is the Vervo destructor mite, which brings all kinds of viruses to your bees. One of them being deformed wing virus. Now, that is not the only way that bees can get deformed wing virus, but it is pretty high up on the list. So the thing is, this virus that the bees have, now if they have deformed wing virus and it's manifesting itself in the telltale deformed wings, those bees can't fly. So how is the virus being spread around? Well, it's being spread around by the adult bees that can fly, that haven't been developed with deformed wing virus. And they can park on flowers, because how many times have you looked at a flower and seen a bumblebee and a honeybee on the same flower? That's what's happening. And that's what these studies have done to show that it's our commercial, specifically commercial stock, that is infecting native pollinators with at least two known diseases for sure. Deformed wing virus, and of course the black queen cell virus. So we're having an impact on the natives, so not just competing with them. So here's the other thing. How did they prove that too? When they went more than a kilometer away to evaluate the flowers, they found that there were no flowers that carried those pathogens. But when they were within a kilometer, in fact, as they got closer to the commercial apiaries that they inspected near, within 300 yards, 19% of the flowers had virus on them. And the virus lasts a long time on these flowers. So they are going across to different species. Because people ask me a lot if Varroa destructor mites, for example, would go to bumblebees or other native bees, and they don't because they're species specific, so that is on. But the viruses themselves apparently can be transmitted, at least these two for sure. But you can look into that university study, Science Daily, June 26, 2019, University of Vermont, and they're studying the impact of commercially managed non-native honeybees on the resident native pollinators. We know that we're doing a lot of damage to our native bees, not just with the honeybees, but we have one protected bee species right now, which is the rusty patch bumblebee, and a lot needs to be learned. We have a lot more study going on. But so I'm not so much worried about the native bees bringing disease to our honeybees, but I am concerned about the honeybees going the other direction and spreading diseases and taking out some of our native. Look at the numbers there of the pollinators that are being damaged. So that's a very interesting question, and I'm just inviting you, the viewer, to do more research on it. If you find something new about that, please feel free to put a link down or in your comment section, put a link there to whatever study you find. This is from Mad Davo, it says. I've read your videos, give me courage to join a local beekeeping club in Sydney and catch a swarm, and I'm loving learning about bees. I know you're a photographer and you make these wonderful videos, so I would like to know what kind of cameras you use regularly for making the videos and surveillance. And you must have a drone too. Would you please tell us about them? Well, this would bore most of the people that are watching here because you're here for the bees. You don't care about the photographic equipment, so I'll save you a lot of time. Down in the video description, I'm going to put links to the camera equipment that I use most often. One would be the Sony series video cameras. I use the AX100 frequently, the AX700, which this is being filmed on right now. So that's my vlogging camera. And I have videos explaining all of those, so I'm going to link that down below. The other thing is, when I get up really close, the macro video equipment that I use right now. In the past, I've used the Nikon D5, insanely expensive body, with a micro Nikkor micro 105 millimeter f/2.8 lens, and that's what I used to use. But now I have an adapter for that lens, and I carry it on a much smaller, much more affordable camera body by Nikon, the Nikon Z7. And the Z7 is what I shot that recent through the microscope sequence of the honeybee waking up, moving its feet and things like that. And I will continue to work with that, again, with the 105 millimeter lens. So that's two. The drone is, I have a couple of drones. I use the P3 Pro Phantom from DJI and the P4 Pro Plus, which has that crystal light built-in screen on it. And that has all these sensors around it, so it supposedly can't run into things, because I have a habit of running my drones into things. And I will link that down below too, because I go over it a little bit and show you what it's about. So rather than waste everybody's time showing stuff, ooh, look what I have, it's going to be, if you want to see it, you can look at those videos. And I even have a giganto 500 millimeter lens that also goes on the Z-series camera with an adapter. And I have a rig that carries that on my chest so I can go out and be places without getting tired. So those videos are already in existence. Almost nobody looks at them because nobody cares about my photography. But yep, that's what I use. So now we're at the fun part. We're at the fluff part. This is the end of the questions, really, other than the question that comes from John Smith here. And any suggestions for Christmas gifts for beekeepers? Yes, I have a pile of suggestions for Christmas gifts for beekeepers. So then I bounced this off my wife this morning. So I said, oh, what do you think we should get for like beekeepers for Christmas? So the other thing I want to mention here before we get into the specifics of what you should offer for Christmas for beekeepers, who can be very cranky people that are very specific and it's very hard to shop for them and you can't find stocking stuffers. Well, I'm going to help you out with that here. But as we know, today's Black Friday, so there's a lot of sales online right now. A lot of the beekeeping sites are going to have sales that peak on Cyber Monday. But we also have Small Business Saturday. This is all here in the United States. I know if you're in other parts of the world, you don't know what I'm talking about. But here's what I would like to recommend before I get into the list of things that I recommend for beekeepers. One is Small Business Saturday. Let's look at, we all know about Manlake, we all know about Better Bee and Dadon and all these other companies that are big and doing extremely well. But maybe just this Saturday, if you can find it, you get it from the small stores, like the Blythewood Bee Company. Or you'll get your fancy bee suit from Guardian Bee Apparel. These are American companies. Blythewood Bee, it seems like a small store. Blythewood Bee Company is the one that makes Swarm Commander. They invented it, you know. So they have a lot of things, you know, to their credit, but these are small shops that we can support on Saturday. If you go there, tell them I sent you. So Natural Apiary is another one for your suits. And what else can we talk about? That's pretty much it. Guardian Bee Apparel, I like them. Now we get into my list. I had to run all over the place to make sure I had samples of things. So I've divided this up into two categories. The first category is going to be affordable stuff, cheap stuff. Cheap stuff that's useful. So beekeeping stuff, what's the number one thing that you can get for the beekeeper in your life that you care about? Well, for starters, how about an inspection mirror? An inspection mirror, electricians use them and plumbers use them, and they have little telescoping, you know, metal arms. A lot of them have a magnetic thing on them, and it's got a little rectangle-shaped mirror. Another thing you can look at is like dental equipment, medical equipment, like those mirrors they put in people's mouths to look at the roof of their mouth, at their palate and stuff. All of those things work, but the bigger ones are better. They telescope out. Now what that lets you do is reflect sunlight down into your hive or into a cell so you can see it really clearly. So you use those, sun's over here, you know, you're late in the day. Best time to inspect your hive is middle of the day when sun's high, but let's move along. So then you get your reflection, your mirror, and you reflect sunlight down into it and you look at it. There's no flashlight brighter than that. So my number one thing, inspection mirror. Next thing, also to help you look at stuff, a pen light. I have a bunch of these. My grand monkeys steal them from me, apparently, because they're looking for spiders. This is a pen light. That, look at this. It has an adjustable size of the beam. You carry these in your pocket. These things are not expensive. Now, I'm going to put links to all of this down in the video description, but I just wanted to show you how small this is. You carry it in the pocket on your bee suit. You look at something, you want to get a closer look, throw more light on it, and now, yes, those are eggs. That queen is doing great, and she was here within the last 3 days because there's eggs here. You can tell your kids scary stories with them. Right now, the pond monster is terrifying my five-year-old grandson. I told him, flying monkey takedown, bubblegum up the nose, pond monster's problems are solved. So anyway, pen light, get something like that, dirt cheap. Pocket level. Look at this little disc right here. It's got a little bubble in the middle of it. All directions. You drop that right on the top of your beehive. Are we tilting it left? Are we tilting it right? If it's a flow hive, is it tilted back 2 degrees? Pocket level. Carry it in your pocket. You want to know. If you don't trust your own vision, of course, you can just hang a rock from a string, you know. But these are stocking stuffers. It could be fun. So get somebody a pocket level. Beekeepers need level stuff. We know they're level headed. We know that that's already covered. Now next is a no cry filtered flashlight. How many times have you walked out into your bee apiary at night with a white light? This has 3 levels. See? Off, bright, middle, light. This is an LED, so the battery lasts a long time. It's rechargeable. It's water sealed. But if you walk out there with a white light and you want to inspect your beehives middle of the night because you think a skunk's out there, or a raccoon, or there's a bear, or there's a possum or something, the white light gives you away, plus bees will fly right at it. Did you know, by the way, some of the diseases that bees can get can cause them to become disoriented and fly at white light? I just learned that. But then you've got the red filter for it. So I like the no-cry one like this because it is not just a red filter light. I do have the red LEDs where it's all red all the time, but this one doubles as, you know, a work light. It's got a little stand and stuff. I've been using this thing for a long time. Not very expensive, so it's in my cheap pile. No-cry red flashlight, rechargeable, all weather. Oh, You've got people visiting your apiary. They just got stung by a bee. They're having a terrible experience. Well, I know. You're a beekeeper. You get stung 27 times a day. You don't even know when bees sting you anymore. You don't even care. They sting you on the nostril. You're like, psst, that's just every day for me. But for a visitor, that's not fun. This is the best stuff to put on bee, wasp stings, mosquito bites, jellyfish stings, all kinds of insect bites. They're convenient. I make sure our medicine cabinet is loaded up with them. And by the way, if there's anything you're going to put on a bee sting that's going to work quick, it's these things. You break the capsule, you shake it up, it goes out into the little cotton piece on the end, and you rub it all over, and it does help a lot with the pain. Plus, there's a psychological impact. I don't know how much time you spend around children. But when a child is stung by a bee, they don't want to hear you go, you know, oh, did it get your foot? Take the pain. Just walk it off. That doesn't help them. So what you do is you go, oh, come here, let me see your foot. I have a magic thing that's going to fix your foot forever. It's going to be better than it ever has been. You crack one of those open, psychological, somebody cares about them, somebody's taking care of them. Their foot, their hand feels better. They get stung in the face. It's a little awkward. But sting kill is what that stuff is called. Stocking stuffer. And what's another thing? You can get them. I made videos about collecting swarms with butterfly nets. Big ones. Commercial grade professional butterfly nets. That's intermediate. Not super cheap. Not super expensive. We're talking $30, something like that, with shipping if you're from Amazon or whatever. That's what I use to collect swarms now. It is the best swarm collection system ever. Big aluminum butterfly net. For your beekeeper that has everything and just might have to deal with a swarm and doesn't want to carry a big box up into a tree or something. Butterfly net. These are gems. I'm giving you all the good stuff. A beekeeper's log. Something to take notes with. Not some big thing. I do have a big 3-ring binder, by the way, which has all my big notes in it and all my certificates and, you know, certificates of origin for the bee stock that I keep and all that stuff. Apiary registration, those are all good to have, but you need what we used to call in the military, we call it a paper brain. You had your little wheel book. So there are these little yellow, they're made by Little Giant. Different companies now are starting to put them out, so they're copying them. But and they have weatherproof paper, so you get like a Sharpie and you use permanent ink and you make your notes while you're out in the bee yard, because people have things that happen in the bee yard and they forget about it later. So if it's not right in your pocket, right with you, right at the time, people are not going to document things. So these little wheel books, by the way, they're kind of pricey. $6 to $10 each, but they're in my cheap category. Stocking stuffer. So when you have a backyard apiary and you only have 3 or 4 hives, it's great to have that. And make sure you have identification numbers on your hives so you know which one you're talking about. Left one, right one, middle one. But identify the hives. So there you go. Beekeeper's log. That's another stocking stuffer Christmas gift. And then this ties right in. This is great. I'm so glad that this question was asked because I didn't know how I was going to bring up something else that somebody who's starting a new product line sent me for free. How about garden pollen feeders and nectar feeders for your sugar syrup? Let's say, you know, your kids want to get involved. A friend from Lifeline Bees, LLB, his name is Mike, sent this to me. Look at that. What is it? It's just the top. I'm going to show you how it goes together. So you get these. Everything here that we're looking at was made on a 3D printer. And I noticed that, and the surfaces look kind of rough, but actually, you know what? That benefits the bees because they can climb on it. So this falls into the novelty category, maybe semi-prank category. If you could get all your neighbors in your neighborhood to get pollen feeders and then you provide them with the pollen to put in it, and when they ship this stuff to you, the box included this Ziploc baggie of this very suspicious and familiar substance. So I sniffed it and I wrote him right back and I said, is that Man Lake Ultra Bee Pollen Substitute? And he said, yep, that's what it is. So here's the gig. You give this to your beekeeping friends or whatever. But if you could get people in your neighborhood educated about bees, maybe they can't keep bees, but they just want to help. So now you can hand out this pollen feeder. What goes in that? Well, let's put it all together. He also has this cool looking flower thing that goes on top. See these rough edges? 3D printer all the way. By the way, if you're thinking of a gift for me, 3D printer, anybody who cares, who's listening. So the next thing that goes in this is a little lattice piece so the bees can climb up and down on. So here's your fake flower. Goes on like that. This is for the pollen feeder. Doesn't hold much. And by the way, the pollen substitute, Ultra Bee pollen substitute, best pollen substitute on the market. Is it being sold by Man Lake? And it's on sale right now too. So you get that. Now you see this thing all goes together. Then there's a lid for it. He sent me brown or yellow. So I did get this stuff for free. So, and I haven't tried it. I'm just telling you about it. And then here's the top to keep all the rain out of it. So all these pieces go together, and then the bees go through these little holes down inside. So it's protected from rain. It's got enough of an overhang. It's got this rough surface again, because these 3D printers apparently are kind of coarse. But then guess what? There's a hole in the bottom of it. And then these little stems come with it, and a little sign that you put on there. And the sign says, of course, be careful, and has the website. And the website is lifelinebees.com, lifelinebees.com. And the phone number's here. And then this thing sticks right on the bottom. And there it is. It's a garden pollen feeder. And here's the thing about Ultra Bee, by the way. Ultra Bee, once the bees have ever gotten into that pollen, I did it for the first time last spring. Spring's a good time to do it. Once that happened, once the bees understood that scent, anywhere they found that scent, they found it fast. So I was walking away with an empty Ultra Bee bag and got mobbed by bees. Now, they didn't remember the location. They were following the smell of it. So once your bees know that Ultra Bee is a resource for them, they follow that smell everywhere. And that's the only pollen substitute for open feeding that I recommend. So what have you just done? You set up these pollen feeders, you get your neighbors to buy pollen substitute that you recommend and set these out in their yards, and they help feed your bees. And it's only good for early in the spring when the real pollen hasn't kicked in yet, or in some areas where you have a dearth, but I don't have a dearth here. So what else from the same company? Oh, look, here's a blue flower. So true to life. And here's the pollen thing again, which we're not going to use. I'm going to do something else. He also sent these bottles. Look at that green bottle. So what's that for? Syrup. So you can put your blue flower on your syrup bottle like that. And you can put this cover on it. But then how do the bees drink the syrup from the bottom? Oh, look. He has these little, really cool, drown-proof, again, 3D printed little feeders. Goes on the bottom of the bottle. That's the feeder all together. How should it go in your garden? Oh, if only there was another one of these sticks that goes in it with another sign on it. Of course, you can get the sign off. You don't need to have that. Just have the stick by itself. Put that in the bottom. And now you want this to be level, right? It has to be really level. And then the bees will come, and again, you can get your neighbors, give them the recipe. They might be like, well, what's the recipe? So then you make a copy of this page that comes with the stuff, how to make sugar syrup. And then these are all the configurations on the front. And then your neighbors are feeding your bees for you. Of course, bees are probably coming from everywhere to do that. But, so I don't know, and a lot of people are going to be divided on that. Let me just say it ahead of time. Some people are going to say, I don't want strangers feeding my bees, and I don't want, well, you know, bees go into people's hummingbird feeders, and which I have solutions for that too, which people don't seem to want to listen to, but bees are going after everybody's sugared drinks anyway. They're going after your Oriole feeders and stuff like that. So when people say, how can I keep them out of my hummingbird feeders, I say, oh, I have a present for you, and it goes like this, and here's a formula. sheet and you mix it up and you put this stuff in this bottle and then you just put this out in your yard and it will protect your hummingbirds and the bees will feed somewhere else. And then your bees get that boost right there. Again, you don't want to be feeding your stuff when your honey supers are on, obviously, but during periods of dearth and stuff. Anyway, those are just things I thought about. That's a novelty Christmas gift. That would be funny to have, I think. And kudos to Mr. and Mrs. Jenkins there, who are the owners. This place comes, it's in Missouri, Forestville, Missouri. They also have these little essential oil things. I'm not sure what's in them. Ooh, I don't want to open it yet. So anyway, that's a novel gift. Like, you know, what the heck is this kind of gift on Christmas morning that you want to give somebody? Those work. Well, I haven't tried them, but they look like they would work. I'm going to 99% say those things are going to work. So the garden pollen and nectar feeders, that's on the cheap list. And the next one. Oh, this ties into the problem we had. There were bees on the window inside the house. How could I have gotten those? They're way up high. Oh, some of them are on the ceiling. How could I get those? This is what you get. Now, this is intermediate. Not super cheap. Not on the expensive side. This, my friends, is the Bugzooka. And so this is for your young bug collector that's in your house. I have a couple of these Bugzookas. And how does it work? It has these little trap doors on the front, little pneumatic doors. You load it like this. The bellows is cocked. Then this telescopes out if you need it to, or it can be very close. You put this over the little bee like this. Let's say the bee's on the table, which you could just pick it up. It's on the table. But anyway, you go like this. Created a vacuum. This reminds me of the slurp guns that you use underwater to suck in fish and get a hold of them. Now the bee is safely and unharmed in this little capsule. Take the capsule off. There's a screen there so it doesn't get away. And put that in your pocket and carry your bees along. Now it doesn't just get just one bee. Let's say 10 bees were on your window because you came inside the house at the wrong time and they were all over your bee suit. And now they're loose in the house. You can get them from the ceiling. When I gave a bee talk to an elementary school recently, well, before COVID, and there was a spider that descended from the ceiling during the bee talk, and I took out the Bugzooka and sucked that spider right into the capsule and invited all the kids to come up and look at it. Do you know more than half of that class made their parents buy them Bugzookas for their birthdays and for Christmas that year? All because of me. These are great. I've been using them for years. You can pick up wasps. Anything that fits through that opening right there, you can suck it up. So get a Bugzooka. Again, it's a novel gift, cracks people up, especially if you get it out and you're all dead serious about it. There's a spider. Where's the Spider-Man? You go in there, Bugzooka, load it up, suck it into the capsule. It works. What is that? Oh, magnifying glass. Get your beekeeper a magnifying glass. Because, obviously, not everybody can see really well, and those little eggs and things, you want to look at stuff. Magnifying glass, again, it's one that fits in the pocket. And by the way, this is a real glass one. I like the ones that are made out of glass. I don't like the plastic ones. These are ideas. I hope you're writing them down if you want to win over somebody. What else does that say? Pocket something. Oh, a subscription, magazine subscriptions. Did you write it down? American Bee Journal or Bee Culture. Those are the top two here in the United States anyway. So a subscription, a gift subscription, stocking stuffer. Have the first issue rolled up, the December issue, and stuck it in their stocking. Bee Culture or, that's it. And here's the last one of the cheap ones. You could give them a candle making kit because you've got all this wax laying around. Because every time you inspect your hives, you're scraping off burr comb and getting some propolis and stuff like that. Wouldn't it be cool if you could make it into little, I don't know, bear candles? Mrs. Dunn for Christmas. Got a bear candle mold so that she can make a bunch of beeswax candles. She's going to be so excited. She's going to cry when she sees it. She's going to be that excited. So candle making kits. It's already there. Now we're on the expensive side. Now you want to pull out the stops. You don't want to spare the horses. You really care about some beekeeper, and you're going to give them some cool stuff. First thing, top of the list, super expensive, a FLIR C2 thermal camera. Somebody already wrote me about that, and her husband doesn't want to buy the thermal cameras because they're too expensive, and she feels like it's high time he got something worthwhile and got what he wanted, and she's getting the FLIR C2. I've had that for many years. It's an excellent tool. You can find everything. It's cool for that, and today you could probably even use it to see if somebody's got a fever. So a thermal camera, we're talking $500, if not more. Next is a bee suit. They're expensive. Well, they can be, a couple hundred bucks. Guardian bee apparel, number one on my list, ventilated suit. Number two is going to be Natural Apiary, who makes the really good ones, and they have that smock. So I will put a link to some of the reviews I've done of bee suits. But Guardian Bee Apparel, American company, small family. So you satisfy two things. Christmas gift for somebody, plus you're supporting a small business. And the other thing is the most comfortable. They feel like pajamas. They're like super soft cotton. Comes from the Flow company. So I have Guardian Bee Apparel, Natural Apiary, Flow. And Natural Apiary makes that smock, no zippers or anything, just pull it on. You have somebody visiting, you want to show them something in the yard, it's less, I think it's less than $100. So that's borderline cheap to expensive. Some bee suits, $300-$400, Natural Apiary. So anyway, those are other gifts. Last year, a friend of ours gave her husband a really cool khaki-colored Natural Apiary vented bee suit for Christmas. So the next one, a refractometer. Not the $30 refractometer that you get on Amazon or whatever. This is a refractometer made specifically. This company does refractometers for specific purposes. So if you had a state food inspector looking at honey composition and moisture content, they would likely have this MISCO unit. I'm going to give you the number. It is number PA201X. And you can get these at MISCO.com, MISCO.com. This is the Palm Abbey Digital Refractometer, #PA201X. This thing runs just under $400. You don't have to calibrate it. All you do is put a dribble of honey on it, close it shut, hit read, and it gives you the percentage of the honey right out of the gate. Perfect, on the money. The accuracy is ridiculous. So MISCO refractometer, or any refractometer, if your beekeeper doesn't have one, is a tool that is good to have. The other thing you might give somebody is a complete beehive kit. If this is going to be their first year with bees and they haven't decided yet, those things are on sale right now. Doesn't matter where you go. Daydant, Better Bee. Man Lake has been showing some quality issues with their high production, but I can't discount Man Lake. Anybody that's got a good sale going. But I know that Daydant and, or Daydant, however people say it, and Better Bee, they sell these kits that are actually really reasonably priced and include a smoker, a veil, the landing board, the deeps, two mediums. What size kit should you get? One that's at least got two deeps and two mediums. Because then they can use those add-on kits. It's actually two hives almost. Oh, right now, Better Bee, because I just bought a bunch of them. See, now that I bought mine, I'm going to tell you about them, because if they go out of stock, it won't hurt me. They're selling the landing boards to the standard Langstroth 10 and Langstroth 8 frames. The cedar landing boards right now are marked down. So the cedar landing board is cheaper than the pine landing boards right now. So I just bought a bunch of them. And guess what? They're the reversible landing boards. And guess what one side of the reversible landing board is? What's the height of the shallow side? 3/8 of an inch. What's good about that? Mice can't get in. They can't get in there. So right now, those are on sale at Better Bee, the cedar landing boards. Tell them Frederick Dunn sent you. Pay the same as everyone else. So hive components and stuff. But, you know, be careful. If your beekeeper that you're shopping for is highly opinionated, you want to kind of make sure when it comes to hive equipment that you're going to get something that they're actually going to use. So that's kind of hard. The other thing, if you're looking for high-end stuff, if somebody's getting serious about beekeeping, a dissection stereo microscope. So they run the full range of price, mid-range, $350, $400 for a stereo microscope, so they can look at their bees. They can examine them underwater. They can examine them under the microscope and see, like, you can look at more nosema, things like that. So, and this is going to be, the next to the last thing is a pyrography set. Pyrography is wood burning, but they're running into a lot of money, the really good ones. And I'm going to put a link to all this stuff. I think it's called tree something. I'm going to be wrong. So I'm going to just put the link in there. But you can get pyrography kits so that people can, you know, personalize their boxes. Even if it's just writing their signature on there, they have basic stuff like that. But if you compare that to these electric irons that brand your hive equipment, those things are ridiculously expensive. For the cost of a branding iron, which probably would make a good gift, but if you bought one of those branding irons, you could have a whole pyrography kit that lets you freehand anything you want, so you're not just stuck with whatever text is on that branding iron. So, and last but not least, as we'll wrap it all up, hive butlers. I just got them this year. That's a hive butler back there. I'm storing my off-season frames. I have full frames of honey in them. They're heavy duty. They close everything up. They protect your frames from pests during winter. And I like the hive butlers, and I recommend that you get the 5-pack. And because it's under $400 for a 5-pack, they come with lids, and you get a screen lid, so you can even transport swarms with it to your isolation bee yard. And so if you get that and you use FRED10 as your checkout code, they'll discount you $10 or 10%. Sorry, FRED10 is 10%. So that'll save you $30 or whatever on your price. And tell them I sent you. Of course, when you use the FRED10, they'll know it. I get nothing back from any of the companies that I've named. They don't pay me. They don't care if I tell people what to do. So that's it for the gifts. How many of you are going to do oxalic acid vaporization treatments on your beehives? The number one method, if you're using oxalic acid, is the vaporization method. When would you get the most effective treatment of the entire year if you live in the northern United States or some cold climate? Right now, end of November, 1st of December is when my bees, right now it looks like my observation hive has no brood. They're at that low point. So if you looked at brood production parameters for bees in our area, they're getting their all-time low. What does that mean to you as an oxalic acid vaporization treatment person? If you've had problems with the colony that has had a lot of varroa on it, you could actually treat it now and get more than 97% efficacy because the brood is not there. Now, this is interesting because it's basic math. What if we had to do treatments of oxalic acid, which some people are doing? This is troubling to me because some people think oxalic acid is so non-impact on the bees that they're comfortable treating it. Please don't do that. So, you know, whenever we're dealing with pests in our apiaries and the varroa destructor mite is at the top of the list, we might go overboard with treatments because we're so anxious to get the pest. If you knock down 70% of the varroa mites in a colony, it sounds like a good number. So if you knock out 70% of those after two or three treatments, more likely you'll do three treatments, 5 to 7 days apart, because you had to do something because the varroa was getting high. Now here's a, not getting high, their numbers were high. So anyway, the varroa numbers were high. And then you treat them with oxalic acid vaporization, you knock some of them out. But when you look at some of the recent studies that I have, which is pretty interesting to me, from Bee Culture magazine, February 22nd of 2016, they were doing the math. How did I miss this? I've been reading this forever. But if you treated now, you would take out 97% of the mites on average, in some cases even higher. And then they add up how many cycles, how many reproductive cycles that the mites need to recover their numbers. And of course, they can only reproduce when your honeybees are reproducing too, because they need pupa in order to reproduce, right? So if you treated them now for the colonies that need it, and you took out over 97% of those mites, do you know that it takes them almost the rest of the entire year to recover their numbers? Because what did you leave them? 3% of the mites are residing there. So now we have 3% of the mites that have to reproduce, and then their offspring have to reproduce, and their offspring have to reproduce. And so the exponential math goes. And in order to get back to those numbers, takes them almost an entire year. Where if you only killed off 50%, they recover in just 1/5 of the year. 75% of the varroa in a colony slows the population by the equivalent of approximately 2/5 of a year. So here's the thing, unless you're really getting high efficacy, you're going to hate me right now. Oxalic acid vaporization knocks down the mites, it does, but not enough of them to where they can't just bounce right back and all of a sudden you can find yourself overwhelmed with mites again. Again, because of those bad neighbors, those bees that are right next to your bees that are handling it, and they're carrying so many mites, and they're providing a lot of more opportunity for those mites to reproduce, which is why these huge colonies, these giganto multi-box colonies, can generate huge amounts of mites because it corresponds with the number of brood that they've got going on there. But anyway, let's clear the deck and say that if you treat it now in the Northeast, of all your opportunities to treat for mites throughout the year, the most effective treatment would be. Now, when the brood's done, 97%, and the lasting effect of that would carry them right through the spring. So, that's my closing food for thought for you. I want to thank you for watching today. If you have any questions, please put them down in the comment section below. Don't forget to hit the like button so you know that you've watched this episode. And I appreciate that you're here, and I hope you have a lot of fun shopping. I hope that things are going well for you and that you had a fantastic Thanksgiving for those of you that are here in the United States. And just have a great weekend. Thanks for watching.